So I know you said that your approach is agnostic to whatever the final quantum gravity theory may be. However, one of the initial motivating reasons to go into string theory was that, as a side effect, it produced a massless spin-2 field. So it didn't produce a massive one. I don't know if the fervor would have initially been as intense had it produced a massive one. So how do you make sense of the disparity between the string approaches to quantum gravity, which predominantly have massless spin-2 fields, and then yours? And if massiveness is up for grabs, then is spin-2-ness up for grabs, like maybe graviton?
Yeah, good, amazing question. Let me just start by telling you that, in fact, the first model of string theory, bosonic string theory, actually came in with a massive spin-2 field. It was unstable, and that wasn't a supersymmetric version, and there was all sorts of different problems. But in fact, the first model of string theory came up with a massive spin-2particle. That doesn't mean that I do believe that a massive spin-2 graviton would come from string theory. I don't think so. At the moment, the indications seem to suggest quite the opposite. But this is just to say, in fact, we have many different realizations, and we never know for sure what is going to be the final outcome. Now, we have learned a lot from understanding what is possible to come from string theory, in fact, and what are potential high-energy completion of massive gravitons. So I think I like the approach of remaining quite agnostic in precisely what the high-energy completion is, so long as it satisfies some basic rules that we discussed about earlier, like causality, like unitarity. And it doesn't need to be string theory per se, but we want, however, physics manifests itself at very high energy, we want it to be so that it satisfies these very simple rules, without which I don't think we can even make sense of reality anymore. And we don't even need to have a notion of graviton. We don't even need to have a notion of quantum field. It can be something quite different. But some of those fundamental concepts, like unitarity, in the sense that if I have some probability of given outcomes, I want the sum of those probabilities to sum up to one and to be positive. I want causality to be satisfied. These are very much the ground rules for what we want to base ourselves on. And then it can be string theory, or then it can be something quite different. It doesn't matter. From that, you can actually make contact with how physics manifests itself at low energy. And we know that there are some models that I can come up with. There are some models that I can write down. Mm-hmm. And that seems quite consistent at low energy. And I can even convince myself that they could be good representations for what happens in the world that I observe, in the experiments that we make. And they seem to be self-consistent within the remit in which we want to probe them. And yet those models, in fact, we know they will never be embeddable. They will never have a representation at high energy, or they will never come from a high energy representation of physics, which is consistent, which is unitary, and which is causal, for instance. And so these are good outcomes, because then we can carve out a whole region of models. We have carved out all sorts of different ways to represent the world, which otherwise would have seemed consistent. But we know it's not consistent with having a high energy completion, which is unitary or causal, or those kind of Bayes rules. Now, for massive gravity, at zeroth order, it is already challenging because of all the modes that come in to be embeddable in a standard high energy completion. If, in addition, I want the high energy completion to be weakly coupled, in the sense that I have a standard perturbative approach all the way up to high energy, then we know nowadays that this will not happen. Whether it is a disaster for massive gravity, some of my colleagues would say that's a disaster for string theory. Uh-huh. But in the reality is that even in string theory, it's not the case that it necessarily needs to be weakly coupled. We have to make a distinction between what is easier to keep traction on, what is easier to calculate, where we can actually make more predictions and make more progress, and the realm of all sorts of other possibilities. And this is where the distinction is. A lot of the time, we go much further in directions which are easier to calculate. That's the truth of the matter. When things are weakly coupled, when things are more perturbative, it's much easier to make traction in some directions. And in those directions, we know that we're not going to be able to make contact with massive gravity. The graviton will have to be massless, and that's the end of the story. So that is definitely true. And so in all of the string theory realizations that we have at the moment, we can't make space for a massive graviton. It'll have to be a massless graviton. So they can be massive spin two fields. And in fact, we do believe in string theory, there will be massive spin two field, but there's never such a case where you have what we call a gap, a separation of scales between a small remit where you have massive spin two fields, for instance, and a large gap, and then nothing else, so that we can treat those massive spin two fields as being a low energy effective description for the world in which we live in. It's always a continuum of states in between. So That is the nature of it. Does it mean that massive gravity is ruled out? Possibly, I don't know. It is in tension with the standard realization of string theory. That is definitely true. I would say, though, that better understanding how you can have a realization which builds on this strong coupling, which is very challenging to keep track of and very challenging to get predictable, observable from, is actually interesting in its own right. And I don't know whether this is going to be ultimately realized, but I still think that it is an interesting direction to study. And it is possible that ultimately, even for our standard completion of the world in which we live in, we're going to need to rely on a strongly coupled high energy completion. That may just be the reality. And in that, if that's the case, then it'll be much easier to understand how to make sense of it in sort of a toy model, as it is the case in massive gravity, as opposed to a fully fledged theory of quantum gravity. That is for the mass of the graviton. For the spin, so long as you follow a standard approach where you think of the spin, first of all, that's also a consequence of a symmetry, which is Lorentz invariance. So everything that a lot of the things I'm thinking about that people would be thinking about in string theory and in a lot of high energy completion are still within the remit that Lorentz invariance is a fundamental symmetry. So the world in which we live in right now is not Lorentz invariant, but that's a spontaneous breaking. And if I were to zoom into a very small region of space-time, you'd think that you recover this Lorentz invariance. And so if you have Lorentz invariance, you have all sorts of related quantities associated with it. And one of them, like the notion of mass, and another one is the notion of spin, which is discretized. And you can have a spin zero, like a scalar field. And in fact, there are, before general relativity, there were models for gravity which were based just on a scalar field, a spin zero graviton, if we were. Now we know this is completely incompatible with observation. You can't have gravity being just a spin zero particle. You wouldn't get gravitational waves, but you wouldn't even get the right behavior in the solar system. Okay, so we can't have that. A spin one particle that corresponds, in fact, to the photon. The photon is a spin one particle. It's massless. You can have massive spin one particles like the W and the Z bosons. We also know that the graviton cannot be a spin one particle. It has to be at least a spin two particle. So really the question is, could it be the case that the graviton is not a spin two particle, but it's a higher spin particle, and we're just seeing some subspace of the graviton, the spin two subspace of a higher spin particle? There are some models out there. There are some models out there with what it means to have a spin three particle and an even higher spin. In fact, it's quite challenging, we know, just to have a higher spin particle interacting just by itself without having an infinite tower of other higher spin particles being present as well, that we know. And in fact, String theory is just that. It is a spin two and a whole higher spin tower of all the particles that come in along the way. That's what string theory is. So in that sense, part of string theory is having the spin two as one of the states, but a whole tower of higher spin. So we, in fact, embrace this spinness for grab in many of the models of quantum gravity. Mm. We know that we can't just stop at one given spin. The thing with spin two and higher spin is that as soon as you switch one on, as soon as you have a spin two particle, and I'm not talking about a mass here, just in gravity itself, as soon as you have a spin two particle, we know that its behavior, as you go to higher and higher energy, it grows too fast with energy to be consistent at high energy. And so you actually need to have an infinite tower of higher spin states, where when you resum everything together, that's what's taming down the high energy behavior of, here I'm talking about amplitudes of probabilities and things like that. But we know already if you take general relativity, you have the spin two particle, you're going to need at some point to have an infinite tower of higher spin states that come in to lower down a little bit the behavior of gravity at high energy. That's the only way to have sensible high energy completion of the theory. And that's why we know that general relativity in its own right can't be the final answer. We need to have along the way all sorts of other particles that will help taming down the behavior of just the single graviton at high energy.
Are you working on a theory that gives mass to the photon? What else are you trying to give mass to?
In principle, you can give mass to anything you want. I am actually working in a theory. I can tell you one question I have is related. It's lots of questions that I have every day. There are these let's say swampland conjectures or landscape conjectures. One of them is called the weak gravity conjecture. The weak gravity conjecture tells us that we would think, for many different reasons, which are very well founded, that in fact gravity should be the weakest force there is. And we can think of this around a black hole. We can think of a black hole having a mass, but also having a charge with respect to not necessarily electromagnetism, but it could be an electric charge, but also another kind of charge. And so we would want we would want to be able for the black hole to evaporate its charge faster than it evaporates its mass, because as it evaporates, we don't want it to become too charged and become a critical black hole, which would lead to a naked singularity. So this is a very, very simplified way to explain the weak gravity conjecture, in the sense that we would like to being able to evaporate into charge more rapidly than evaporate into the mass, if you want, or we would like the gravity to ultimately be the weakest force around. So a lot of my work is trying to understand how to think of this weak gravity conjecture and whether we know that from the high energy completion of quantum gravity, whatever it is, the ultimate completion of everything, in fact, we can derive this weak gravity conjecture or slightly modified versions of this weak gravity conjecture. But something else I want to work about related to your question is the long gravity conjecture.
Hmm.
So I told you that in, I don't know how much I want to to go into that. Don't start working on it.
Is it because it's too new?
It's too new, yeah. Now, let me just say, one question I have is if it were the case that the graviton could have a mass and the photon could have a mass in principle, then I know that I can't embed that in a weakly coupled high energy completion. But let me allow for myself to have a strongly coupled high energy completion where some of the bounds that have been derived are not quite as rigid. So let me enable this possibility and think about whether it could be the case that the graviton could have a mass. In fact, the photon could have a mass. In fact, every particles have a mass. It may be just very, very small. And the bound we have on the photon mass, observationally, that's nothing to do with me, but observationally, there's reason to believe that from the coherence of magnetic fields in galaxies, the bound on the photon mass is of the order of 10 to the minus 20 electron volt. I should say, in fact, there's some very nice papers by some colleagues of mine, Giad Vali and Lasha, who've gone through this analysis again, and I think they have some very nice results in showing that there's a little bit more leeway into that. Anyways, let me accept that in principle, the photon could have a mass, and if that were the case, the bound is not so stringent. In fact, the bound is weaker as compared to the bound we have on the graviton mass just from observations. Now, I'd like to understand whether from being able to embed these theories in a consistent high energy completion, not necessarily weakly couple them, but it could be strongly coupled even, whether it is the case, whether it would be possible for the photon to be lighter than the graviton or not. And I think that's an interesting question in its own right, because if we can come up with a way to understand as to why the graviton should always be lighter than the photon, it can be massless, but if it had a mass, it has to be lighter than the photon, and in fact, lighter than any of the other particles that exist, it would tell you that at long distances, gravity is always the force that survives. So it would be a long gravity phenomenon in some sense. All the other forces in nature will have to be switching off faster than gravity. So that's just one idea I've been trying to think about for breakfast, but there's lots of things that come up every day.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of TOE, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/TOE, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.